Check 1, 2. Can you guys hear me now? Hello, check, 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 check. Check 1, 2. Can you hear me at all? Check 1, 2, check 1, 2. Okay. Yeah, I don't know why my, this has been the last 2 weeks from hell, I tell you what. We, with our website, I don't know how somebody got in, but somebody hacked it inside. It does not affect you guys at all. There's no viruses, there's no nothing like that. It's just they got in and they made these pop-ups. And so we've been fighting that. And then today I did the Wicked Lick. Was anybody on the Wicked Lick today? And I did the Wicked Lick, but we didn't get the tab up. So I got that fixed. And now I'm here with you. But my freaking audio won't work. I got this awesome audio that I normally use, but the audio is not working the way I want it to. So I'm going to go back and try it one more time. If it doesn't work, I'm just going to go back to the webcam and we'll use this. Yeah, it doesn't work. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to make sure you guys can hear me. Can you hear my voice okay? Now I'm going to need to turn my guitar up, I think, a little bit. Okay. Can you hear me okay now, Scott? Okay, everybody can hear me? All right, now I'm gonna play a little guitar because I gotta readjust this. So I'm gonna play a little guitar and see if you guys can hear me, okay? Does that sound okay or do you need more or less? Guitar sounds okay? You guys can hear that okay? Okay, we got two okays. We got one more, a little louder. Is that a little bit better? Yeah, the more I try and turn up, the more it's going to fade in and out. That's going to be the problem because these webcams, they compress so bad. So if you guys can hear that, if you can tolerate that guitar sound. Okay. If you think that'll be okay, then I'll keep it there. Otherwise, I can try and turn it up a little bit more. But yeah, that's always the problem is it just winds up compressing so bad. Okay. Yep. Let's see. Okay. I don't want to spend too much time on this. I don't want to waste your guys' time here. Does that sound okay? All right. Perfect. All right. So let's go ahead and get started. First of all, thank you everybody for being here. Yeah, it's been a crazy time. I just finished up a new guitar course, which has just been a lot of work too, getting that all ready. And then we had this website thing, which just sucks, man. So anyway, we're working on that all the time. And right now it looks like everything is doing pretty well. But if you guys hear anything, let us know. Jake, thank you so much. I'm glad you enjoyed the Kiss tribute show. Did anybody else happen to watch me on Saturday night with the Kiss tribute thing? That was fun. Man, that is one of my favorite. You know, the beauty of what I get to do, especially as I get older, is I just get to have fun with a bunch of players that I enjoy, and we go out and play for an hour or hour and a half or whatever, and then we're done. You know, I used to be a road dog, so I used to have to play from like 9 to 1 or 9 to 1:30 or whatever it was. And now I just don't do that stuff. I play for an hour, hour and a half, and I'm out of there. So it's cool. Anyway, so what we'll do today is you guys can let me know what kind of questions you've got about anything, whether it's playing, whether it's gear, whether it's guitar questions, theory stuff, doesn't matter what it is, playing on stage, changing strings, I don't care, it doesn't make any difference. Rip it up, or rip it out, like by Ace, yeah. The funny thing about that band is that I get to live my dream of being Ace Frehley, which is so freaking awesome. So, like, I love singing some of those songs. It's pretty awesome. So, and there is a recording of there actually is one Kiss tribute show already on YouTube, I think it's on the Steve or Stine Music Lessons channel. It's on there. And then this one, the one that I did last night, will be on there sometime this week. I'll get it out there. But we're just trying to get everything put away and organized and all that sort of thing. Scott, we were at a place called Rick's in Fargo, North Dakota. And then actually, I'll put it out pretty quick here too, but this coming Saturday, I will be playing at another club with my metal band. They're called, the band is called A New Machine, and we'll be playing for an hour and a half, I'm not sure, then too. So we play Slayer and Megadeth and Anthrax and Pantera and Sepultura and I don't know, just a bunch of metal stuff. Metallica, obviously, all kinds of stuff like that. So we're playing this Saturday, and I'll post something on Facebook about it too. So if you guys want to join me, we'll do that on Periscope as well. So let's go ahead and get started to your stuff. Steven says he's disappointed that nobody smashed the guitar. I smashed a guitar. I've smashed two guitars in my lifetime, and neither one of them turned out very exciting. It wasn't like they exploded. They just went, and then they like broke right here, and then that's it. Is there a recording Kiss tribute? We just talked about that. Is GuitarZoom debugged now? Andy, I don't know. I don't work on that side of things, but I think so. I hope so. But like I said, when we first came on, there's no, like, you're not going to get a virus or something. It's just what happens is somebody comes in there, they go through the through a hole, and then they have pop-ups that pop up so they can try and solicit their own materials. So our guys have been working through the frickin' night trying to make sure that there's no holes anywhere. But if you do, you know, find something, please let us know. The only thing is there's certain things on the website that we have to rebuild again because we had to do, I forget what they call it, restore. I don't know what they call it on Windows, but where you go back like a week to make sure there isn't anything in there. We had to do that with our whole system, so we're back a little bit. Let's see. Dean Zielinski guitars, Bob says, are they good? I don't know if they're good. I've never played any unless those are Dean guitars, which I've played Dean guitars. I have a Dean guitar here. But Dean Zielinski, I don't know what that is. So Brian says home recording tips and what happened to Metal Corner? What happened to Metal Corner was the link that there's another one of my issues for the last week. The link that Glenn was trying to log in with didn't work. And I was at a birthday party at a swimming pool with my family and a bunch of other people. So I'm trying to fix it on my phone while everybody else is eating cake. And so that didn't go so well either. So guys, holy crap. It's been a hell week for us here at GuitarZoom. If anything could go, all I could do is smile. Because what else could I do, man? Everything goes wrong at once. It comes in three, so I'm hoping that now that we've multiplied it by two and we're at six, we can stop crap happening. Did I stop sending out email notices about Wicked Lick of the Day? Yeah, Jeremy, everybody on this call, just all you have to do is go to Stine Music Lessons on Facebook, and that's where they are right now. I do them at 2:00 Central Time, Monday through Thursday. Fridays are really tough for me because Fridays I'm usually trying to get things organized. And so it's what happens with Wicked Lick of the Day is I spend the mornings trying to plan what I'm gonna do. I get the jam tracks ready, get the tablature ready, the PDF, all that kind of stuff. And then I got to make sure that I actually know what it is I'm gonna teach because I got to learn it sometimes. And then I have to do it. So it takes a lot of my morning to do those Wicked Licks. Sometimes they don't take a lot of time, but it's really tough to do those when I'm like trying to do guitar courses and stuff. So what I try and do with Wicked Lick of the Day is every day at 2:00 Central, 2 p.m. Central Time, I do the Wicked Licks on Stine Music Lessons. So if you go on Facebook, look up Stine Music Lessons, that's where they are. And then what you can do is subscribe to them on Stine Music Lessons, and then you'll always get notified when one starts if you're on Facebook at that time. So let's see here. Let me go back here. So hopefully I answer your questions, guys. David says, you sing good. Thank you, David. I am a singing stylist. That's what I am. I do not have any vibrato, and I do not sound like David Lee Roth, and I do not sound like George or Jeff Tate from Queensrÿche. I can't do anything like that. I'm pretty one-dimensional when it comes to singing. I do a lot of harmonies, and I do songs like people like, you know, I can do Poison and Ace Frehley. Anybody that has that kind of regular voice, I could do things like that. But otherwise, I am just a singing stylist is what I am. I just play with people that actually can sing, which is nice. Jeremy says, about the Wicked Lick. What is the best way to go about mastering tones on a Les Paul? Jim, if you've got a Les Paul, and guys, you can keep loading them up. I'm going to get to all your questions here. But Jim, mastering tones on a Les Paul, it's pretty easy to get a decent tone off a Les Paul. My question to you is, what is it that you're running into? What gear are you using to get a tone? I mean, a Les Paul is going to have more of a fat sound versus like a Stratocaster will. You know, it's got the three toggle switch, so you've got your pickup, you know, humbucker, single on both sides, and then a humbucker. So they're kind of fat all the way around. I mean, that's what a Les Paul sounds like, but I've never had a really tough time trying to get a good tone from a Les Paul. But remember, Jim, depends on what brand of Les Paul, or not brand, but sometimes there's off brands of Les Pauls. Sometimes there's lesser expensive Les Pauls. Even if you buy a really nice Les Paul, the pickups might still not be exactly what you're looking for. You know, there's all kinds of different things like that. But usually, if you get yourself a decent Les Paul and you plug it into a halfway decent amp, you're gonna have a good tone straight off the bat. I think it has more to do with your amp, Jim, than it does with your Les Paul. Randall, the new machine is on Periscope a while back. That is correct, Randall. And then we'll be on this Saturday night as well. So I'll try and do a little bit of advertising for that show as well. We haven't learned any new songs. It's the same tunes as usual, but you get to hear Holy Wars and, you know, a 15-minute Kiss medley of all the fast songs and all that kind of stuff, which I love that band too. I love playing in that band as well. Let's see. Eric says, I keep hearing different things, but what is your thoughts on how often to change your strings? Eric, I change my strings before I gig for sure, before I do a show. What I do is if I have a show Friday and Saturday, I'll change my strings usually Wednesday so they have time to stretch out and I can play them, lock my system down, all that sort of thing, make sure everything's cool. I don't like to change them Friday if I have a show Friday because it's just too close to disaster. So I'll always try and change them a day or two ahead of time. But if you're not gigging, just in a general sense, how often should you change them? That's up to you. I would say you should probably try and change them every month, maybe every couple of months. I know people that haven't changed them for 2 years, you know. It doesn't hurt anything, I suppose. But fresh strings feel really good. They're really smooth and they sound really good. You know, like I play GHS boomers for strings. And the reason I use boomers is because I like the brightness of them. When they come out of the package, they're super bright and it's really easy to get bite and all that kind of stuff off a GHS string. I love boomers. You know, I used D'Addario for a while. And again, they're all great strings, but GHS are the ones that I really like to play. The only problem with GHS strings is they tend to die fairly quick. So, you know, with GHS strings, they're not going to last for 6 months. And thank you, David. Restore point is what I was looking for. They're not going to last that long. But again, it depends, Eric, on what it is that you're doing. I mean, if there's no right or wrong to changing your guitar strings, it's just what happens if you're an electric player is over time, the oils on your fingers and stuff can cause your strings to start corroding. And if your fingers are dirty or anything like that, then you get gunk built up on your strings. And yes, you can clean your strings and they have string cleaner that literally strips all of that stuff off the strings. So you can do stuff like that too. But honestly, a set of strings is, you know, anywhere between $5 and $10. It's for me, I love the feel and the sound of new strings. So I like to change them as much as possible. I try and change my strings every 2-3 weeks. And again, unless I have a gig. When I used to gig on a regular basis, like every weekend I was playing, I changed them every week. Every week, a day or two before I'd go out and play. So hopefully that helps you a little bit, Eric. There's no right or wrong in how often to change them. I would recommend somewhere around a month or two. If you want to change them more, God bless you. If you want to change them less, that's fine too. It doesn't hurt anything to have old strings. It's just if you like the sounds of them, it's worth putting them on. Steve, have I ever played at Borrowed Bucks? I have played at Borrowed Bucks in Bismarck. I've played at Borrowed Bucks in in Bismarck, but I've never played at Borrow Bucks in Fargo. We used to play at Borrow Bucks in Bismarck quite often. I was thinking if they had a Borrow Bucks in Grand Forks, but I don't remember. I don't think so. I don't know. I've played a lot of places, so I honestly don't remember, but I know we used to play there on a regular basis in Bismarck. John says, what is happening with the quizzes? John, I think it's the same thing. I think what happened with the quizzes is when the site got hacked, it screwed up a bunch of stuff in there. So the guys are having to go back and rebuild everything. And guys, I apologize. I know it sucks for you, but it sucks 10 times worse for us. So again, our guys are on the ball. If you know Tom and those guys, they're on the frickin' ball all the time. It's just crap happens sometimes, and this is crap that happened. So I think that's what's going on with the quizzes. John, what you could do, and anybody else out there that's trying to take quizzes and they're screwed up, email me directly at steve@guitarzoom.com and put attention Steve. How should I put this to make sure it gets to me? Say attention Steve. Quiz, put this as a subject line, put attention Steve quiz, and then I'll make sure that George has them go directly to me and I'll deal with those. But guys, I'm telling you, I'm just asking you to be patient for a little bit, because they really are. Tom's been working through the around the clock trying to get this stuff working, and I think that's what happened with the quizzes. Is I think it just threw everything for a loop. Our blogs, I mean, just a bunch of stuff that we were doing, and now we have to do it all again, which really sucks. And Randall says that's been an issue on his Chrome lately on his own machine. Yeah, yeah. I don't really understand all of that kind of stuff. I'm not a computer guy in that sense. You know, I do recording and things, but I don't understand all of those other things. But I just know that the team has just been stressed getting all of this fixed. And we're just doing the best we can. So I apologize for that. William says, what is Periscope? Periscope is an app that you can get on your mobile device if you have an Android or an iPhone or something like that. And all you do is you watch people do stuff. Like you go on there and you can watch somebody talking about whatever. You can watch somebody playing whatever. You can watch somebody fixing their hair. And there's a million things on there that you can do. You can also get it on your PC and I believe on your Mac. I don't have a Mac, but you can get it on there and you can watch stuff as well. So if you go to, for me, if you go to Periscope, is it periscope.tv? I think that's what it is. Periscope.tv/Stine Music. If you already have the Periscope app on your phone or whatever, if you just go to Stine Music, you'll find me on there. So that's what it is. Okay. So let's see. Dean Z guitars. Yeah. I don't know anything about those guys. Tech, yeah, Randall says tech is great when it works well. It is true. And when you get attacked, I guess we had a meeting about it. And I guess the good news is if we got attacked by somebody, at least we must be on the map somehow that somebody thinks it's worth attacking us. So that's a good thing, but it just, there's no real light at the end of the frickin' tunnel with that. So last week was horrible. It was a horrible week for all of us at GuitarZoom trying to get all this done and trying to get it up. And I know it sucks for you guys too, but believe me, we are working constantly trying to get everything so it's back to the way it was. So I apologize. Ed says, I have the greatest outlook. Let me tell you something, Ed. It's not always easy when things go wrong, but you have to, I'm telling you, the thing that I always think about, like my stepmom has stage 4 cancer. And my best friend, I'm not trying to down you guys, but my best friend died not that long ago, about 5 months ago from cancer. And he was younger than me. I'm 45. He was 44. And there's just not enough time for it. You know, you have to try and do the best you can to enjoy, and I'm not trying to be weird to you guys, but you got to try and enjoy every day, because who knows what it is. And you don't want to wake up, you know, on your last day going, man, I wish I'd done this. And I wish I'd said this. And don't live like that. Just do the best you can. Always find a light at the end of the tunnel. So you can find the light at the end of the tunnel, right? Okay, so Brian, I'm IGPA in GuitarZoom, but I don't use Facebook. Yeah, Brian, I know a lot of people that don't dig Facebook. I don't dig Facebook, to be honest with you. I hate a lot of, I mean, Facebook for me is a pretty negative place. you know, when you have a lot of, like I have, you know, the maximum followers and all that stuff. So I try and really avoid the negativity of it. But Brian, if you're not on Facebook, it's worth joining, even if all you did was become part of our GuitarZoom community and you didn't do anything else. And I wouldn't blame you for not doing anything else. But even if you just joined the community so you could read other stuff and watch other people's videos and post some of your videos and talk about guitar, you know, I am a huge advocate for, when I was a kid, I used to have a, I got a hair hanging there. When I was a kid, I used to have a buddy of mine that lived down the street from me, and he played guitar as well. And we would get together and we would just talk about bands and guitar players and singers and the best song we knew and the best album and, you know, what kind of strings so-and-so used and what kind of guitar so-and-so used. And I tell you what, I think those were some of my favorite times of just having these comfort, like even Saturday night when I went out and played with my Kiss tribute band. It's fun because I get out there and I talk to people that I don't talk to very often. And it's always these conversations about, hey, have you heard this new CD by whoever? And I love that kind of stuff. And that's what I aspire the Facebook community page to be. It's just a place where everybody can get together and go, hey, have you heard this new album? By the way, everybody out there, my favorite band right now that a friend of mine turned me on to that night on Saturday, no, it was last week, it was during my band practice, is a band called Spiritual Beggars. It's got the guitar player from, he's a metal guy. He's from like, I forget, he's not in Carcass, but he's in, his name is Michael Amott or Amott, and he plays in Arch Enemy and a bunch of other bands. He's in a ton of metal bands. But Spiritual Beggars is like a cross between Cry of Love and Deep Purple, and it's this cool kind of bluesy, you know, rock thing with heavy keyboard stuff. And man, if you guys have never heard Spiritual Beggars, you should go check them out because they are fun. It's such a fun band. Okay, so let me keep going here. I'm so sorry, I'm getting off on tangents here. Thank you, Lance. Hi, Ray. Ray says hi. Steven says, take a break and do Kiss as a Wicked Lick for a week. You know what? I've got a couple of Kiss Wicked Licks coming up pretty quick here too. So somebody had requested Mr. Speed and a couple other ones. So I'm kind of trying to span them out so I can get to little things I know everybody likes. Like today we did Pinball Wizard, the beginning of that, which has always been one of my favorite things by The Who. So I'm trying to do different things to kind of please everybody. And I'll keep trying to do that as best I can. Any news about the IGPA summit dates, John B. says? Anything you can share? To be honest with you, I'm not exactly sure, but I'm going to write that down. That's not a, it's got to be on my radar. There's somebody else that's working on it, and I get so caught up in all the stuff that I'm doing that I forget about it. So, John, I know there's a lady that's working on it right now. And again, John, email me at steve@guitarzoom.com and say, you know, inquiring about summit, IGPA summit or something like that. And if I don't answer it, what George does is he puts them in a post that we all read and we'll make sure that we get to that. Cause you guys need to know when that is. Again, I know it's in October and I know it's in Nashville, but I don't know anything else about what's going on with that. But as soon as I get off this Q&A, I'm going to look into that because I need to know what's going on too. Yeah, Scott says, it's been frustrating, and some of the courses are missing, and I've got a couple duplicate courses. Yeah, I'm telling you, we got nailed. We got freaking nailed. So, Scott, same thing for you. Anybody out there, if you're having content, your courses, if your courses are missing, if you've got stuff missing, again, email me at steve@guitarzoom.com and say, missing content. Okay, call it content because that's what it is. That's what makes sense in our head. So, and then say, hey, you know, I'm missing this course, whatever. And George is going to keep track of everything, and I'm going to read those as well. We're trying our best to get everything up there. So, God, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry about that, Scott. It sucks. I wanted to play because of Ace 2. Yeah, shock me. There you go. Yeah, that whole song. Let's see. Yeah. I'm telling you, the weird thing about Kiss is the songs are way more involved than you'd ever think they would be. There's more crap in there than you think. So it's pretty funny. Let's see. Jim says I-Core amp. Just confused with all the options. The easiest thing you can do, Jim was talking about his Les Paul earlier. The easiest thing you can do is don't try and overwhelm yourself with like delays and blah, 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 blah. The easiest thing to do, Jim, is start by just dialing in a good rock and roll tone, which is pretty darn easy to do. Just something where you can crack it. You know, and you just get this nice crunchy. Kind of thing. That's what you're looking for in a guitar tone. It's something just raw. And then you can dial it in a little bit more if you want a little more distortion or a little less distortion. It's pretty easy to do from there. But let's see. Brian says, Ibanez RG450, but I'm used to acoustic player. So many tremolo systems on RGs. Well, there are. I mean, and the problem with tremolo systems, guys, is that because a guitar has a tremolo system doesn't mean it's going to stay in tune very well. You know, it depends on the tremolo system and that sort of thing. Tremolo systems, for the most part, like I have a floating tremolo system on these Ibanez Gems. Tremolo systems, for the most part, suck because they're limiting. Yes, they're fun if you are a whammy guy. If you use a whammy person, not a whammy guy, but if you're a whammy individual, they're nice to have. I grew up with this sort of thing because I grew up, you know, playing in the 80s and that, but you know, like right here, I've got this one right here. Okay. This is an ESP, right? And this one has got a standard bridge on there. It's just a stock bridge. So if I was on stage playing that guitar and I broke a string, I can keep playing. If I break a string on this floating tremolo, this guitar becomes completely unusable. If I want to tune that guitar to drop D, I just drop it down. I can't do that on here because I'm locked. And even if I could tune it down, all the other strings are going to go up because it's a floating tremolo. I mean, everything, you know, changing strings is way more work on here. I'm not saying don't own one. I'm just saying be prepared that owning anything with a tremolo is a lot more work than having just a standard bridge. So, you know, so when I play on stage, I really need to bring two guitars with me because if I break a string on this, the guitar is completely unusable. You know, it's not like it goes out of tune together, all the strings. It goes crazy and it sounds horrible. Like that. I don't know why I'm doing that. It's kind of a vampire thing. I'm not sure what that is. Okay, let's keep going here. Let's see. What's my favorite low power amplifier that does not have tubes? Orange has got a lot of good stuff that doesn't have tubes, that's low power. I like a lot of the Orange stuff. I think their stuff sounds really, really fat, and I don't mean that like a hipster. I mean, it sounds fat with an F, not PH. It sounds fat, it sounds thick. I like that stuff a lot. That's what I would say. Orange would probably be my favorite. So let's see. Talk about developing rhythm and play some in 12/8 feel and then play the same again in a different 4/4 feel. Can you give me an example of what you mean, Klaus? Explain to me kind of an example of what you mean by a 12/8 feel and then make it into a 4/4 feel. Let's see. Douglas says he changes his strings every month. That's what I do. Once a month, there's another one, fast fret. David mentions fast fret. Fast fret is awesome for trying to make your strings a little bit, especially like if you have humidity or anything like that, fast fret is really nice because it makes the strings really smooth. Cleans them up a little bit. Doesn't clean the backside so much, but you can buy this stuff that's almost like alcohol, just alcohol swabs. I'm not saying use alcohol swabs, but they make this stuff that you can kind of pull on each string and clean it, and it does a really good job. So have I tried cobalt strings? I have, Lance. I've tried cobalt strings. I liked them. I wound up going back to GHS. I wound up going back to my same old, same old. But I did like them. I used an Ernie Ball cobalt of some sort. And then there was another one that I got as a as a test. This company sent me some cobalt stamped strings, but I don't remember who it was. But those are good too. Yeah, cobalts are great. Again, there is no right or wrong to guitar strings. GHS is not the answer for everybody. I just, they've always worked really well for me. Let's see here. Randall, can you give us a quick lesson on finger tapping? Yeah, Randall, real quick here. What happens with finger tapping is basically what you're going to do is, I'm trying to get the reflection off there. Basically what you're going to do is you're going to use two or three fingers for the most part down with your picking hand or your fretting hand, and you're going to use a tap with your picking hand. I was outside all day, so I'm trying to get my act together here. So what I do is I do my tapping with my middle finger, as some of you might know. I don't cup the pick like this, like Eddie Van Halen does, because all too often I wind up dropping the pick if I'm on stage. So I always just hold onto the pick like I normally do, and then I just use my middle finger to do my tapping. So let's just real quick here as an example, Randall, what we're going to do is, what I do is I stabilize myself by kind of grabbing onto the bottom of the neck like this with my third and my pinky, kind of hold on. And then I use my arm to deaden out the strings up on the top so they don't start making sound. So as I see, I got that instead of this, I control them. And now I'm just getting sound from that one string. So I'm touching on the bottom, I'm controlling myself, and then I'm touching up here. Then what I'm going to do, I'm on 12 on the third string. And then what we're going to do is go 5 and 7 on the third string as well, just like pentatonic. And what you can do is you can push down, you're going to tap that, you're going to smack that string, then you're going to pull off. Okay, now you'll notice I'm flicking towards the ceiling. Some people like to push towards the floor like this. It feels incredibly uncomfortable to me, so I don't do that. I always go up, and then I'm going to pull off, and then I'm going to pull off again. So I'm flicking that string, pulling off, and then I'm going to keep going. Okay, and there's all kinds of different ways of being able to, you know, there's all kinds of different things that we can do with tapping, but that's the concept of how tapping works. Okay, let's see here. Jeremy says, saw my cousin's band the other night, couldn't hear vocals at all, lead guitar super quiet, set list was one that nobody was into. Can you talk about sound checks and what you feel is most important thing for cover bands to consider to avoid emptying the place? Jeremy, that is a big conversation that I should really make a course about someday. But here's the deal. I'm going to be brutally honest with you and everybody else, okay? When you play in clubs, unless you have a following, unless you have a built-in following, if nobody knows who you are, okay, you either are going to go in with a bunch of other bands and one of those bands has a following, right? At some point, what you have to remember, and I'm gonna be brutally honest, guys, there's a million things we could talk about with this, but I'm just gonna try and kind of point to what Jeremy's saying here. If you don't want to play to an empty place, okay, first of all, here's the rule. You are playing for a bar owner. Your job is to play music that people want to hear, so they sell alcohol. That's the bottom line, right? If you're playing in a bar that sells alcohol, the bar makes their money by selling alcohol, okay? They might make money off the door when you come in, but oftentimes the band is making money off the door, right? And if very few people show up, you're not gonna, the bar's not making much money off of that, and certainly the band isn't as well. So most of the time, the bars will pay you, either they'll pay you a flat rate for a guarantee, they call it, or they'll pay you, you know, you can have the door. You can charge what you want for the door. Whoever shows up, you keep that money. Or you do a door versus a guarantee, which is if you make this much money, or if we make this much money as a bar, we'll pay you above and beyond what this is, this guarantee, if you can draw more people in. So the problem, Jeremy, is trying to figure out as a band, what to play. Like the first thing everybody always thinks on our side is, what do I want to play? What do I want to play? Well, what you want to play may not be what everybody wants to hear. If you have a band that plays country, but then plays metal, and then plays bar mitzvah, and then plays reggae, and then plays jazz, you might be really popular, but chances are you might not be, right? So if you're a country band, you're going to try and market to a country audience. If you're a rock band, you're going to try and cater to a rock audience. If you're a rock band and all you're trying to do is play really, really, really obscure stuff that nobody knows, people, again, you're going to get some people that are into it, but you're not going to get the majority of people. Jeremy, what makes men go to a bar? Women, right? Where the women are, the men are. So Jeremy, if you were in a band, how would you get women to show up to watch you play? You'd play songs that women could dance to. That's what you would do. You play Fish in the Dark and you play whatever, whatever, you play whatever, whatever. Those are the kind of things. Now, I'm not telling you all this is what you should do. If you're asking me how you pack a place, that's how you pack a place. Now, I've been in bands that I've packed a place. I've been in bands where I don't pack anybody, okay? Like with what I do now, because I've spent so much time playing in bands, what I do now is completely the opposite. I don't even care if I get paid when I go out to play in a band. My job is to go out and entertain people that enjoy coming out to see me play. And I don't try and play what's popular or classic popular, modern popular, anything like that. I just do what I want to do. But there was a time when I most certainly had to do that. And I hear this a lot as an argument from original people that people that are in original bands and like, well, I'm never going to sell it and I'm never going to play. And that's all fine. But you're not going to pack the place either unless you can find a way of creating a following. So Jeremy, this is a way deeper conversation. And believe me, I've made a billion set lists and named a billion bands and with the bands I'm in and booked thousands of times and all that sort of thing and talked to bar owners and negotiated payment and all those sorts of things. But it's definitely a larger conversation. So Jeremy, we're going to talk about this again later too. Yeah, the web hosting company, John, I don't even know who that is, buddy. Lance says he likes Ernie Ball Cobalt Strings. Yeah, I liked them too. I thought they were pretty cool. And let's see. Randall, you still have all your courses. Yep. If you are missing something, just let us know. They're rebuilding everything. That's what they've been doing for the last few days is rebuilding everything. But if you are missing something, let me know and we'll make sure that it just gets back in there. I would never screw you guys. You would never get screwed out of your stuff. So if something's missing out of your account, just let us know and let me know. Email me at steve@guitarzoom.com and we'll make sure everything's back in there as needed. So let's see here. Periscope.tv, Stine Music. Thanks, John. Thanks for posting that. I appreciate that. Let's see. Have I ever built a do-it-yourself amp kit? Oh, my God, goodness, Donald, I have never done that before. I don't know anything about the inner workings of that sort of thing. Yeah, I don't know anything about the inside of an amp. All I know is what I do is I plug in and, you guys have probably been on a few of these webinars with me, but these Q&As, but if you remember me talking about how I take my guitar everywhere I go, my guitar is my prime. My amp is my secondary. So my guitar, my pickups, that sort of thing is what I take to Guitar Center and I plug it into an amp to try it out. Or when I have guitars, musicians friends send me some amps to try out, they'll send me some things and then I'll test them out, but I always test them out with this guitar. So that's how I do it and I very seldom ever find something that I plug into and go, I can't make that work. I honestly can make just about any, and I'm not saying that like, whoa, look at me. I'm saying really, if you got a good guitar and it feels good and it sounds good and you know what it sounds like, you can plug into just about anything and dial it in to get a decent tone. The only thing I find is that some amps have a few limitations to what I prefer. Like a lot of amps will only have so much gain. Well, sometimes I need more than just a little bit of gain in my metal bands or when I'm going for a solo or something, I need to push it over the top and then need to be able to back it off. That's one of the limitations that I see, but that's really the only limitation that I ever see. So, let's see here. Cool. Okay. I'm just trying to make sure I got everybody. I'm doing a lot of gabbing here. So, is GuitarZoom thinking about allowing downloading to our courses, to your courses, to your hard drives? I don't know. Let me mark that down again. And let me find out what I can find out. Okay, let's see here. David says rotosound strings are his choice. Yeah, you know what, Greg? I've never tried rotosound strings, ever. Never tried them. I should probably do that sometime. I know I'll wind up going back to GHS anyway, but I, it would be nice. Let's see. Eric says, using an ES-335, what might be a great overall home amp to use to get that blues and rock ringing tone? And maybe the heavier on occasion? Well, I mean, a Marshall is kind of the pony that works for just about anything in that regard. If you're looking for something, you know, Fender with a 335 is always quite nice. A Fender amp is nice with that. You know, where for me, like, you know, going with something like a Mesa Boogie or something like that, I think is a bit much. You know, honestly, Eric, you could try, you know, Orange has some decent stuff that's not overly expensive, so maybe you try that. Again, Eric, the best thing you can do is bring your 335 into a place, just plug into a bunch of crap and see what you think. 6 a.m., Steven says 6 a.m. is pretty good. I like them too. Let's see, I would know. What's the ETA before everything is restored, Randall says. Again, I am the wrong guy to ask because I'm the guy on the other side making the courses. But I would say there. I know today I talked to Tom and he said that they had all the holes plugged and they were restoring everything. So that's what he said today. And then they have a guy that they brought on just to monitor all of the whatever it is that he needs to monitor to make sure the holes are plugged. But he said that's what they're doing is restoring everything. I don't know how long it'll take. I would think, you know, a few days would be enough. So Jeremy says Spiritual Beggar sounds cool. You got to check them out. I'm not even lying, guys. Yeah, it's good stuff. Let's see. Yeah, Ed, I know, and I'll get on that stomach thing. I got to get on that too. I have so many things I have to work on every day, and I forget about that, like the summit. I forget because it's not on my radar, like I said. But I promise I'll get on it. I'll figure out what's going on there. Any chance of putting together a course, webinar, or content related to SRV? Yes, William, it's on the list. It's coming soon. I'm actually going to start doing some in the style of things with a few famous guitar players, trying to give you some more isms of the things that they do. But yeah, SRV is definitely on there. So, let's see. Yeah, thanks, David. Yeah, you're right. I mean, it really does suck for you guys and that the website had a hack. It's not like we wanted it. You know, it's made things really, really tough, but we're working our way around it. We'll get it back up. You know, it sucks, but, and John says, are you using your Taurus right now? I'm not using, here, hold on. Okay. I'm not using it right now. I'm plugged directly into my computer, but this is the Infinity pedal. And this is what it looks like without the Steve Stine thing on it there. But this is the Infinity pedal. The lighting really sucks for yellow there, but you can see the Infinity logo there. The Infinity pedal for me is just a monster. I'm not even lying to you. It's just a monster pedal. You know, I've always used like tube screamers and things like that out front when I do use pedals, and just the Infinity is it really has replaced it. So, and then I've got a Grimstein delay pedal that he made for me, which was pretty cool. And it's a really cool delay pedal too. But that Infinity is definitely my go-to. So yeah, it's awesome. Let's see here. Stuart says, love your honesty, Steve. When something sucks, it sucks. Yeah, well, that's true. What am I going to do? You know, I mean, it's like getting a car accident. Yeah, I mean, you wish it didn't happen, but there's not much you can do from that point. You just got to grin and bear it and make things better. You know, what can we do? So Martina says, hi, Steve. If you have a Yeti USB mic, a digital SLR camera, an electric guitar pedal, I have to review an amp. What else do I need to make a good quality video for YouTube to review a pedal? Martina says, I'm assuming I need an interface. You kind of do. I mean, if you try and run everything out now, you know, I mean, GoPros and you know, the new cameras do a really good job of picking up audio, but if you want pristine audio, you really have to run direct. I mean, that's just kind of the way you have to do it. You know, for stuff like what we're doing right now, if I wanted a really good tone, you know, running over the internet, doing webinars is hard enough because the signal gets compressed and sent off. But when you're doing actual recording, you know, just to set up an amp behind you with your camera running and try and talk and have your amp at the same time, it's pretty tough. It's always better if you can run everything independent. So if you run your voice independent into a digital audio workstation, a DAW, and then you run your guitar independently into something too, especially if you're going to review the tone that you're getting, because the tone gets lost out here. I mean, if I just, well, you're hearing it right now. I mean, that's not a good representation of what the tone should sound like. And again, I don't know why that's working, not working. I got to fix that too. So I need pizza. That's what I need. That's what's going to fix this. So, okay, let's keep going here. Sorry about that. Jonathan says, do you have anything that teaches different open tunings? Rob Ash did a thing with slide with open tunings, and I did a little segment on open tunings in Play Acoustic Now. I think it was. There was a part in there that had open tunings, but not a big one. So open tunings. Maybe I should just do some courses, some small courses just on each tuning. That might be a good idea. Thank you. Open tuning courses. I'll put that. Open tuning courses. Does anybody else do this? You write down notes, and then when you come back to your notes, you can't read what the heck you wrote. I do it all the time. So I'm better off typing, because I write, and my 7-year-old always looks at my writing, and she goes, Dad, nobody can read that. And I'm like, yeah, I can't even read it. So anyway, let's see here. Whammy Tech and two guitars. Yep. Do I intonate my own guitars? No, I go to Flatland Guitar and Paul at Flatland Guitar here in North Dakota, in Fargo. He does all my stuff for me. I bring him my guitars and I go, please fix them, and I need to pick them up on Monday or Tuesday or before Friday, and he'll have them done and I'm ready to go. He is my guy. So let's see. Yeah, well, and that's the thing. Marco says, my Finnish friend corrected me when I quoted the whammy bar being a tremolo. Yeah, guitar term, when you say tremolo bar, people know what you're talking about. Yes, whammy bar is more the correct term, but when you say tremolo bar, we're not talking about the tremolo effect. We're just talking about, you know, the fact that we can, which is giving the tremolo effect is what it is. That's where the term came from. But yeah, whammy bar, tremolo bar, whatever you want to call it, tremolo system. Because, I mean, people do, like, you know, it's called a tremolo system is what people refer to it as. So, yeah, either way, it's perfectly fine. You should tell your friend not to be so worried about or so particular about it. It's fine. Whammy bar, tremolo bar, we all know what you're talking about. Whammy is just a slang term. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yep, that's right. Let's see here. Switching from GHS to Dunlop. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. D'Addario's and Dunlop and GHS and all, you know, Ernie Ball, I used Ernie Ball. They're all quality strings, guys. There's no doubt about it. In my opinion, it's just you got to find which one fits your fingers, your ears, your guitar, your playing, which one works for you. And I think it's so easy to get so wrapped up in strings and picks and, I mean, you know, the kind of cable you use and the battery that you put in your effects, you can drive yourself freaking crazy with all that stuff. So I think at some point, what it has to come down to is how does everything feel, most importantly, and then how does it sound from there? Can you work on the sound from there? But always focus on how it feels, I think, more than anything. I mean, guys, I'm going to be honest with you. There are times when I think, if I tried a different set of strings and a completely different guitar and a completely different amp, I might be 10 times the player that I am right now if I just changed everything or just changed this one thing. But when I start looking at everything like that, it starts making me crazy because I don't know. I mean, you know, shoes and the kind of shirt I'm wearing and the length of my hair. And I mean, it's just too much after a while. So the goal with all this stuff is figuring out what works for you. And I know there's a lot of people that go through their whole life and they're frustrated with everything. They're frustrated with their guitar. They're frustrated with their amp. That's why I always tell people, start with one thing and start building it. If you've got a guitar that you really like, and it really is what you, not just that you like the guitar, but it feels right, start building from that. Start building from this chunk of wood. Start building your pickups and your strings and everything from that, and start building outward as opposed to the other way around. So Let's see here. Tortec, Dunlop Tortex picks are great. They really are. In English language, whammy and tremolo bar are the same thing. Yeah, and that's true around the world. Maybe people have different things up, different ways of saying it. Bob says, I really like the D'Addario, the New York XLs. I use those too. I got those free. I got some packs of that free to try out, and I really like those too. I went back to Boomers again because, I don't know, maybe it's just I'm getting old. I don't know. Let's see. Oh, man, you guys are just going. This is great. See, whoever's not on GuitarZoom community, this is why you need to be on there, because look at everybody talking to each other. So this is just freaking awesome. Let's see. Yeah, this is great. Are you guys having problems? Well, I can't even get to the top of this chat. It's so long. I'm trying to get through it here. Steve, I was wondering, is Texas 26 licks the same as 26 Texas licks? I don't think so, but I'm not sure. So David, you're going to have to, I hope you guys are learning that I don't have the answers to all this stuff. I don't have a clue, man. I work on this side. I smile and strum. That's what I do. But David, if for some reason it is, and you did pay for two of them, then you need to let me know, or you need to let us know, and we'll just get you back your money and you're good to go. We don't have any problem with that. We need to make sure you guys are happy. That is the most important thing at all. And I'm not kidding about that. Let's see. Mesa Boogie. Yep, that's good. Guys, I am not trying to rush through your stuff, but there's so many questions and we have like 5 minutes. So I'm trying to, or so many comments. That's what's hard is when you comment a lot. Don't get me wrong. I want you to do that. I want you guys to chat. I just got to get caught up with what you guys are talking about here. Yeah, Jeremy says that would make for a good course, doing something on bar band Bible. I totally think so. Actually, I've talked to some of my friends about it, and we talked about doing like a round the table thing where we just talk about playing do's and don'ts. And actually, the church I'm playing that I play at here in Fargo, we're looking at doing some instructional stuff where we start teaching people the isms of playing on stage for somebody that's never really had the experience, like, you know, how far away to be from the mic, or, you know, like when you're not singing, to move back, you know, so the singer is up and you're moved back a little bit, you know, to make eye contact, you know, just obvious things like that. You know, don't come into band practice with 75,000 pedals and make your band wait for an hour and a half for you to set everything up for a 30-minute or 45-minute practice. Just logical things like that. You know, practicing on a Tuesday night when everybody's got to get home and get ready for work, versus playing on, you know, Saturday night or something like that. You know, oftentimes when I play with the practice with the bands I play with, I just bring a small practice amp, and then when we play on stage, I bring all my gear. But we don't set up and gong gong. You know, I did 25 years ago, but I don't do that so much anymore. Let's see. Da, 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 da. Okay, I'm going to try and get to the top here, and I'm going to ask you guys, can anybody hear me? Because I'm seeing that, I'm just making sure some people are saying that stuff isn't working, like you can't hear me. Can you guys hear me okay? Just let me know if you can hear me okay. Marilyn says yes. Thank you, Marilyn. Okay, perfect. Okay, guys. So, let's see. Okay, good. Yeah, and again, next time I'll figure out what the heck is wrong with my gear and why it's not working. I just chalk it up to this, you know. When I was, you know, 20 years ago, I would have been all frustrated about all these things that have gone wrong and angry and probably whipping something across a room. Now all I can do is smile about it. So that's all I can do. So anyway, guys, I hope you learned a little something. This was a great chat that we had. I always like getting together with you guys and hanging out. And I hope you learned a little bit. You know, we're going to do these once a month so you can ask questions, we can talk about whatever. But guys, just bear with us as we keep trying to get all this crap fixed. And we'll just do the best we can here. So everybody take care and have a wonderful evening. God bless you all, and I'll talk to you soon, okay?